Okay, I guess it's live. Sorry about that. I'm sorry. I don't know what happened. I went to close the doors on my van and lock them and stuff. And when I came back, it wasn't working. So anyways, okay. I don't know what happened to everybody, if they're still there. Anyways, I leave it on and see what happens for a minute. What's up, buddy?
What's up, buddy? Hey, you good boy. How you doing, buddy? Oh, come on, I got something for you. You know that. I got something for you. Yeah, you're a good guy. You know that, aren't you? Oh. Why don't you tell me square? Oh, you're such a good guy. Yes, you are. You're my best buddy.
Anyways, I don't know if you guys are still there, but what happened? Did I put it on? Let's see. What do I have to do to turn that thing on? I forgot. What you doing, buddy? You're a good guy. What's this? What does that mean? What does that mean? Oh, okay. It says enter text for chat. What do I gotta do? I don't know. Well, I'm just... There, it's there. Okay, so anyways... what I was gonna say is... we were talking about that... methadone and stuff... Oh, here. Gotta make it go this way. It's much better that way. I don't know why it won't go that way. It won't go out of portrait. Whatever. Anyway, we were talking about that. The methadone thing, and I said, I don't care, you know, about anything, about what people think and stuff. I don't, you know. You know, this has been in my life an awful long time, and, you know, if I started caring now, it would be, what's up, buddy? Say hi. Here's my guy. There's my buddy. He's a good guy. You see yourself? Look. You're a good guy. Anyways. I said I was down to 58 milligrams. And I was at like 125. I was higher than that at a time. But that's not the objective, you know. But anyways, what I was saying was, I was using it like the Suboxone. What it was I was using the Suboxone like I would go on like a 3-week run of doing dope, and I didn't want to kick, so I would use my Suboxone, you know. I would just wait for like 12 hours and then do like 3 under the tongue, then 3 the next day, then 2, then 1, then 1. Like 6 days and I was done. But the last time I went into some really bad precipitated withdrawal, and it was, I waited the same amount of time and everything, and I couldn't understand it. So I thought that maybe I just didn't wait enough time. So then I did it again after doing another kind of run, and then it happened again, and it was really, really, really bad. And I didn't understand what was going on, because I was like, you know, heroin is fast acting out of your system. In 12 hours waiting, you should be okay to do the Suboxone. Well, I started thinking, maybe what I'm doing isn't really all heroin. And sure enough, you know what it was? Fentanyl. And I didn't know that. You're making me sneeze again. I'm allergic to my cat. Anyway. Yeah, so that's what I found out. I found out that the reason that I went into the precipitated withdrawals was because they're cutting everything nowadays with fentanyl. And, you know, it's like even the heroin on the streets, they're cutting with fentanyl. It's not really heroin. So, you know, I couldn't do what I was doing, which is maybe a good thing, you know. Maybe it's just time that it's all over. So I went to the methadone clinic because I've done that before where I titrate and get down and can just walk away. So this time I'll walk away and I guess it's done, you know, because you cannot... yeah, it should have been done a long time ago anyways, you know. I mean, but what I'm saying is, like, you know, a lot of people don't understand, and they think that you're just doing, you know, you're doing drugs because you want to do drugs the way people do drugs, for fun or for recreation and stuff. And nobody, well, not nobody, but most people would not believe if you actually said you were doing them because, let's see, because you were in a really horrible motorcycle wreck and you had your back broken in two places and broken collarbone and a broken leg and broken arm, broken wrist and broken orbit of your eye and 148 staples in your head. And, you know, I can honestly say, you know, there's not a moment of the day that I'm not in pretty bad pain. My back is so messed up, and there's just not a moment of the day. And the night is almost the same, except, you know, I managed to sleep a little, but, you know, there's no other way to put it. And like I said, I don't lie. I'm just straight honest. And the thing is that everybody wants to say opiates are such, oh, they're the devil and this and that, blah, 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 blah. But the reason that they made them was to take away pain, you know? It's just that we've gone into a society now where I always say it's like, it's amazing in the United States because I've traveled all around the world and I've seen different cultures, and only in the United States do they peddle this bullshit that it's bad to feel good. It's just terrible to feel good. And even if it's a legitimate medical problem, it's still terrible. You should just like, you know, suck it up and take it. And that's like what that fucking Jeff Sessions, that attorney general, he was a piece of shit, you know, for Trump, when he was trying to get rid of opiates and stuff, and somebody asked him, well, what about people with stage 4 cancer? And he said, well, tell them to take an aspirin and suck it up. And I was like, wow, man, that's pretty bold saying that kind of stuff, because you know what usually happens to people that do that kind of stuff and say that kind of stuff? You know what happens. And then they're wishing they never talked that way. So that's the reason a lot of people think that they'll think that I'm doing methamphetamine or something because I'm always moving like this, always. You know, the reason I do that is because I have to take the weight off of my, whichever leg I'm standing on. I cannot stand on it for too long, or it feels like there's being a railroad tie being shoved up my spine. So I have to bounce from foot to foot to take the weight off my spine. And when I did the heroin, I'll say it, man, I have no problem saying the words and saying what I did. When I did it, it took the pain away, and it felt good. It felt good not to have pain. Just that was euphoric. And to be honest, I mean, I never really did it like where people that are doing it to get high to that point. I never did that. I mean, I had a friend that used to do that, and it made me sick, because I'd see him, he'd fix, and then he'd like just slump over and be drooling, and I was like, oh wow, I can see we're gonna have a great time, Nick, you know, we're gonna have a real good time. And I never wanted to be that way. I never want to be that way. It was just, to me, it was euphoric not to have the pain in my back. And I'm going to have to address that somehow when I finally get away from the methadone. Because I'm not saying, you know, I don't want to be on the methadone because of the stigma of people, what they think of you and stuff. That's not it at all. What it is that I just hate having to go there every day. And I hate, even when they give you take-homes, I'm not a little boy. I don't like having somebody act like they're doing me a huge favor, giving me these bottles to take home, and you got to have a lockbox and this and that. And I'm like, fuck you, man, you know? I could go to a dope dealer faster and get it and get home than this bullshit. But like I said, you can't even do that anymore because you're not getting what you think. That fentanyl is in everything. I mean, they're using it in everything. They put it in... I heard they put it in speed, and I thought, that's odd. That's completely the opposite of that. Why would they do that? Well, why not, I guess? Because people keep buying it, I guess, and when people keep buying it, then they just keep doing it, you know, selling it. It's not like that's the only thing I've ever done is heroin. I did speed, but they don't make that anymore. I don't care what anybody says, you know. I see people talking about it or this or that, and I'm like, please, man, I'm older than you. Just, you know, don't even talk, because you're right. It's because it's controlled by the government. You're absolutely right, because I tell people, I'm like, let me ask you a question. I'm like, in like 1995, 96, you could buy a 16th and it would cost like $120, and then like an 8-ball would be like $200. They'd give you a break, so it wasn't 240, it was 200. Now you can buy an 8-ball now for $40, and I always tell people, doesn't that tell you something? I'm like, what do you think, the cartel's being nice to you? No, they're not making it anymore. I used to have a bass player that was a chemist at Cyril Laboratories, E.G. Cyril. They make pharmaceuticals. And he was really smart. And I asked him about this whole situation, and he said, it's simple. He goes, it's not the horse licks or whatever, the phosphorus and all that shit. He said, it's hydriatic acid. You just can't get it. He said, the government made it so tight, so tight. And I said, why did they really clamp down on that more than any other drug? And I don't know if this is true, but he told me, he said, do you know why? He said, because that shit was starting to affect Wall Street. Like the guys on Wall Street were starting to do it, because it would keep them up, and they could, you know, whatever that place is called where they do all that trading. And he said it was really starting to, destroy it, because it is like any drug that, you know, it works till it doesn't work. So, you know, because, I mean, I know that this one lady was asking me, this counselor, so how do you like the methadone? Is it good for your back? Does your back feel okay? And I was like, no, it doesn't. And she's like, well, why not? And I was like, why? I was like, if you're a counselor here and you're asking me why, you should know better than anybody, because any drug you do, your body acclimates to it after a while. And then you have to do more. And that's what you're constantly peddling with, you know, whatever, the drug dog, you know, and all the mad mothers against drugs, about drugs being having to do more and more. And Axel Rose used to do a little till a little didn't do it. Little got more and more. Okay, well, we all know that's true. So why would methadone be any different? Why would they be asking me, does it alleviate the pain in your back? No, it does not. It did maybe the first day, maybe the second day, but not after that. I mean, yeah, right, ether. Also, ether was a key ingredient. Yeah, that's true. But, you know, I mean... You know, it's like I always say to myself, well, somebody probably has the right ingredients and can make it, like a guy that really knows how to make it. But see, I never really care that much. To honest to God, I never care that much about drugs that much. That, you know, the heroin thing, it was like it alleviates the pain in my back, and I got definitely dependent on it, addicted, whichever, both the same word. People like to say dependent that don't want to say addicted because they think that they're rubbing shoulders with scumbags. But to me, I could care less. You know, some of the best people I know were scumbags, you know. So, you know, but as far as drugs just for recreation, I did my share of acid and all this stuff. And is there really any higher you can get than acid? No. And that's high, and that's spiritual stuff. And I always looked at that as something that was very personal and private. And I used to do it with a band that I was in, and we would set the evening up like the way we wanted it for the takeoff and for the landing. Like, you know, when we were up there in the stratosphere, we were listening to stuff that was very, you know, real esoteric, like, you know, real for cerebral stuff. And then like the King Crimson, Starless, and Bible Black, and things like that. And then for the come down, it was like Floyd into like stuff like, you know, that was more earthy. And then down, and the same thing on the way up, you know, like kind of just like, you know, pot stuff on the way up. And then for the peak, the real crazy shit. But it was, the point is, it was a controlled environment, it was a controlled trip. And yeah, I've done DMT. DMT, I don't know if I did DMT, but I did that stuff that somebody said is very similar. That's Salvia, Devonor. And I just know I didn't like it at all. You know, I mean, it really made me... it was really weird. It was like I was tripping on more that I couldn't believe it was legal. And they were selling it at, like, smoke shops. And I thought, man, if a kid did this shit and was driving their car, most definitely they could wreck or would wreck. And that was really freaking me out. I was just like, why is this legal? You know, it's really strange. And then they had that stuff, spice. And somebody told me it was like, you know, fake marijuana or something. And I tried it. And it was like fake marijuana. But then like a couple of years passed and somebody told me, oh, spice, then they're talking about how crazy it is and this and that. And I guess it turned into something like spice is like angel dust or something now, or PCP, because the way people describe it now, it's nothing. They don't ever say, oh, it's like synthetic marijuana. That's what they were saying when spice first came out. And when I tried it, that is what it was like. It felt like you got a reefer buzz. But lately, when I hear people talk about spice, they're talking about it in the context of it being really bad. Yeah, Salvia, yeah, that's what I did, and I didn't like it. You know, I didn't like it at all. I mean, when I was younger, we were doing, like, window pane and, you know, window pane, orange and purple microdot, stuff like that, and MDA. The real MDA, not MDMA, MDA, and it was great. And, but see what I mean? It's like when I say it was great and I'm looking back on it fondly, that's because we really, it was always with a band, and we really planned the occasions out, that, you know, real privately, and it wasn't like some of the kids in high school that would say, oh, we got some acid, man, and we went to the carnival. And I was thinking, I couldn't think of anything worse than being tripping out in a carnival or amongst people that, jocks and shit. I mean, oh my God. It's just, you know. Yeah, window pane was, it was the shit. Yeah, somebody said that about spice. Spice, yeah. But spice, when it first came out, it really was like a reefer simulated, a reefer buzz. And then I didn't hear about it I wasn't into it. I tried it, and it was like reefer, and I was like, big deal. If I wanted reefer, I'd buy reefer. I don't smoke pot. I used to, but I don't smoke it. So Now, though, I hear people talk about it, spice, and they say, like, they talk about it more in the context of it being like PCP or angel dust. So I assume it's morphed into some crazy shit, which is only the way of the American drug culture and society. It's like they always take something that is subtle and ruin it. Like what they've done with pot, just one of the reasons I don't smoke it. It's like now they have these strains that, you know, they crossbreed it, hybrid it, and do this stuff where they have these contests and rivalries against each other's dispensary. Who's got the strongest shit? And my son, he smokes it, which I don't like, but, and he tells me, oh, this stuff, you take one hit and you're out of it. And I'm thinking, that's, sounds like such a, like, not the point. The point, like, when we were younger, was we passed the joint around and we would be cracking up and laughing, and it was a social thing, you know? It was fun. I mean, you do a one-hitter and you're out of it, you might as well take a pill. I mean, that's not what weed was to me and to my friends, you know? It was, I remember the next day, I remember some of the next days where our stomachs were sore from laughing so hard. Where our rib cages were so sore from laughing. And it just didn't, you know, they turned it into this stuff now that it's like, you know, they all have these edibles now and all this shit and all the accoutrements for it. And accessories that are, I don't know what you would say, that are like, ancillary to it, you know. I don't know what's the right word, but they have all this shit for it now, you know. I miss the old skunky smell. Yeah, I remember my friends and I used to get this stuff from Hawaii, and it was in coconut flake cans, and when you'd open it, you'd hear the vacuum pack, like, tsh! And you know what, it had purple hairs, and it was like plenty strong for me. I mean, I didn't like weed when it got to the point where you take a hit and your lungs, like, expand and you're going to cough your brains out. Or, you know, I mean, some people like that kind of shit. I don't. I'm not looking to, like, have some pain, you know. Exactly. It was more of a ritual. It absolutely was more of a ritual.
Nice to see you are streaming, Harry.
Who's that? Who said that? Well, that's nice. Thank you. Yeah, you know, I mean, the drug culture in this country, it's like, I remember when we went to Amsterdam and we went into the Bulldog Cafe, and it was very much like, I heard the Bulldog was a really hip spot, right? And so we go there, and when we get there, I'm looking at a place to me that looks like the Hard Rock Cafe. And apparently at one time it was a cool place in the Stone Age, this other place. But because of America and because of people coming over there so much strictly for that, they turned it into like a tourist thing. And it looked just like the Hard Rock Cafe. And I was like, this is gross. And they had for sale on the menu the weed and stuff. And you could always tell the Americans, the people that were sitting there smoking pot and stuff at the table, because the people that lived there, they were so used to it that it wasn't a big thing for them. So they weren't doing that. That was the one of the things that I, in Concrete Blonde, that I had that started loosening up the bonds of our friendship, was stuff like that. Like Jeanette was smoking in there and had to be, you know, ordering off the menu. And, you know, I was just like, I'm not going to do it. I'm not doing it. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to be the ugly American that comes here and, you know, I just want to go where I can smoke legally, man. It's such a trip doing it in front of a whole bunch of people. You know, to me, that's not a trip. That's gross. I mean, I don't know. I always use these things, including pot, for musical exploration, I would say. You know, that's where it started, and that's where it kind of stayed. I never liked being high, like at the movie theater or like at a carnival or something. I never liked that, you know. I don't know why. I never did. But Yes, it was like a ritual. You know, you'd pass the joint. And nowadays it seems like, well, maybe because of COVID or something, but it seems like kids don't even want to share a joint because they're afraid of the germs, you know? So they have their one hitters or those things, you know, those vape things that they put shit in. And I'm just like, how, what a crazy fucking generation, or the generations have turned into. It's like, I remember us passing around the joint, you know, with like five guys or something in the basement when we were practicing or jamming, you know, and it was a gas, and we would be laughing so hard. And usually it was just ragweed. It was like Mexican ragweed, you know? But we got high off it. Yeah, that's possible, you know, but I just didn't want to do that in front of, you know, I just didn't want to do that because it's like now, you know, it's like when I see all these kids by the dispensaries and stuff, it's also a big thing I would have to say that's like taken me away from it. It's just like, I don't know, man. You know, and it's not doing it to be a rebel or something, but there is an amount of truth to, like John Lennon said it. He said when he had short hair, people had long hair. When he had long hair, they had short hair. When people start doing things and it's accepted, it is no longer like a, you know, it's no longer like a personal thing to you, you know, it's like, it's been accepted. And it's kind of like when, like I have a lot of friends that are gay, and one of my friends, Kenny, he's really, really funny. And he was really upset when they made the gay marriages legal. And I was like, why does that bother you so much? And he's like, you don't understand. He's like, because we don't want them to be our friends. We don't want them to say, yeah, we get it, it's okay. Because first of all, he's right. First of all, they really don't get it. Second of all, they really think you're just a fag, and this is all political. And the gay community's too smart, and they know that. So when Obama made the gay marriages like okay, a lot of gays really resented it, and I could understand why, through the thing with like the pot, like, you know, because I was like, I don't even want to do it anymore. I don't want them to be my friend. The establishment is not my friend. They never will be. Brian Wilson, I worked with him. He's nuts. Because the guy, Jim Mankey, the guitar player for Concrete Blonde, his brother Earl Mankey, used to produce the Beach Boys. And ever since we would record at Earl's house in Thousand Oaks, there was a motorcycle there. And I always wanted it because it was a dirt bike that I wanted all my life. It was like a one called an Osa. And he said, no, I can't get rid of that because that's Dennis Wilson's. And this was when Dennis was alive, you know? And then, then he died, and I guess he really didn't want to get rid of it then. But anyways, Brian, man, he's wild, you know? He's cool. I mean, you know, the Pet Sounds was one of the greatest albums that revolutionized, you know, psychedelia, and besides, like, Donovan, hurdy-gurdy, and Pink Floyd. It's really funny because everybody turns to Floyd and Sid Barrett, and that's true, Arnold Lane and, you know, See Emily Play, but Donovan was a little bit before that even, and Brian Wilson too, but, you know, I love Sid Barrett, and The Madcap Laughs is one of my greatest collection. That was one of my greatest records I loved, you know, to listen to. Yeah, you know, but yeah, you're right. I could look at it like I'm getting some of the freshest weed, but I was never into it that much. I mean, it just, you know, those are the kind of people that are like connoisseurs of stuff. And I don't think I was ever even smart enough to be a connoisseur of anything, really. But it's okay, you know, I'm a simple person. I just like to play my drums, and you know, and I don't know, you know, that's a lot of things that Johnette from Concrete Blonde really resented it, of me saying stuff like, you know, saying that I'm simple and stuff, but I don't mean simpleton. I mean that, like, when we would do MTV interviews and they would ask us who our favorite authors are, and of course she knows that I love to read, and Hermann Hesse I love, you know, who wrote Steppenwolf and stuff, you know, and you know, but when they would ask us stuff like that, Johnette would have to rattle off, like, you know, Tolstoy, Dostoevsky, things like that, and I just thought it was so pretentious and so predictable. And that when they would get to me and they'd ask me, so who's your favorite author? And I would say, Dr. Seuss. And she would be like, why do you always have to be a clown? Why are you a clown? And I was like, I'm not being a clown. That's the truth. Dr. Seuss is one of my favorite authors because he does the most important thing in reading, and that's getting a child to take the first step and enjoy it. You know? And Mel Taylor and Jeff Porcaro. Jeff Porcaro was the best. I mean, Jeff Porcaro was excellent. I think it was a shame that he died young. I know his wife didn't even allow his parents to the funeral because she said they raised three drug addicts or something. I don't know. It was a big family shit fight. But I know Jeff played on some great stuff. I mean, you know, he's great. It is great, but 67 before 67, but listen to some of the Frank Zappa stuff, like in 64, Susie Cream Cheese, you know? Anyways, what was I saying? I forgot, what were we talking about? Why aren't you using a traditional snare drum? Not that you need. I'm a fan. No, I don't use it because that thing I'm using is all the drums are in one, including the snare. It's 18 inches by 18 inches. It's a cube. You know what I mean? It's a cube. It's a wooden cube. It's like a cajon, but I have drum heads on it. Like, picture drum heads on a cajon. So how big of a snare could you put on there? My snare is, you know what size the snare is? 10 inches. It's a 10-inch skin. Okay? So it's a 10-inch diameter snare. And it's a cajon. And so you got a 10-inch diameter hole in the top of an 18 by 18 cube. So once you put the 10-inch hole in there, how much does that leave you for the toms? The toms are the size of roto-toms because that's all I could fit on there. So you'd have to see it. You know, I could post a picture of it or something. But the thing is, it's a cube, you know? It's like about, I don't even think it's a yard tall, but it's about, I'd say it's about 30 inches tall. It's about 30 inches tall, 18 inches by 18 inches, like, you know, on the top and on the bottom. So it's like putting drum heads, or like putting the rims, you know, on your school desk. How many rims could you fit on the school desk and what size? And if you had to make one of them a snare. So I made the snare a 10-inch, and then there's a rototom skin that's like, you know, it's the tiniest rototom. And then it's like a 6, and then there's an 8-inch tom, and that's all I could put on there. But they all share the same shell because they share that cube, except for the snare. The snare, there's a chute going down it all the way to the bottom of the cube. And on the bottom, since there's no sharing of the surface, I have the whole surface. So even though the top of the snare is a 10-inch, the bottom is a 12-inch. The snare, you know, the cellophane kind of skin, you know, the snare skin. So it's just the reason I got that is because I knew the guy that was making them in Sweden, and they can't get them here in the U.S., and I helped him design it the way, and it's called a gig pig, G-I-G-P-I-G. If you look it up on the internet, you'll see it. They're very cool. They cost about $2,000. I tell people that I made it out of a IKEA end table. I'm just joking around. But I love it. I just love it, you know, because I've had so many different drum sets in my life. And you know what? It really comes down to whether you can play them or not, you know. And the thing is that I don't need anything more than that. And live, it sounds great. It's just, you know, coming through the internet and stuff, it does sound like it's in a tin can. I have a Roland TD-17 that's a really nice kit, and I might use that for what I'm doing. But see, the thing is, I don't really make any, like, donations and stuff that much online, because I just started doing it, and I don't really know what I'm doing, and I don't count on that. But I go out every day and I play. And when I play, it's an unusual looking drum kit. So people come around just because it looks like a washing machine or something. I mean, it's a double bass too. I put two 14 heads. There's two 14 inch like snare heads that I use for bass drums. And also, if you've seen it, like if I shot it from the front, the bass drums, the beaters, hit it from the audience side, not my side. From the audience side, the beaters hit the skins, the bass drum skins. It's because there's a U-joint going around the corner from the pedal, you know? It's pretty wild. Yeah, Roland, you know, they make great kids. Yeah, it's a double bass, you know, but it's a really bizarre setup, you know what I mean? It's just that, like, it's very unusual also looking. So when people see it, like, they've never seen the beaters on the audience side. Oh, I do. I play for a long time. You know what? I play because I love to play. I just love to play. I mean, you know, you see, like, if you're watching or some people watching, that when there's no more people left, like, I always go by Staples when they let out for, like, any of the basketball or hockey, and I try to make a few dollars, you know? But, like, when they're all gone and everybody's left, I'm still playing there, you know, and I play all night because I just love to play, you know? I really love to play, and there's not any apartments around there, so nobody's going to bother me or call the police, so I just keep playing, and I don't think about it, but yeah, it gets tiring. I mean, you know, if I was to lay down right now and close my eyes, I'd be asleep in 30 seconds, for sure. Yeah, I always had drum sets, but, you know, I could show it to you, you know. I could take this out and show it to you. I mean, you know, I love drums, and I love drumming, and I love talking about them, but I'll show it to you since you didn't see it, because it's very strange, and not many people understand. Oh, no, I forgot to put the bomb pops in the freezer. Oh, am I an idiot? Oh, my God. My cat was trying to tell me. I know you were. You're a good boy, you know that? Oh, my God. Oh, they're not that big. Okay, we gotta freeze these up. I love these bomb pops, man. I live on them. Oh, man, I love them. Ah, why did I do that? Okay, where's my keys? Yeah, I'll show it to you. It's a very unique design. It's amazing, too, because they don't sell them in the United States. And all these people that see it, They're just blown away by the design, you know, with the pedals coming around the corner. And yet, this is like what I was saying, the attitude, though, that people have, like the guys at the Hollywood Drum Clinic here in L.A., you know, I don't like going in there just because I just don't. They got real attitudes. They think they're just like, you know, the end-all, be-all drum place. So, but I had to go in there one day, and I needed to get something. And I just thought for the hell of it, I would tell them, you know, because they were talking about a drum set. These two guys, one of the guys that works there, Stan. And they were talking about it, and I just thought for the hell of it, I'd say, if you guys saw what I got in the back of my van right now, you guys would be really intrigued. And their attitude was like, he goes, I think we've seen everything there is to see that's concerning drums. And I was just like, oh, fuck you. I was thinking, fuck off, man. You guys are such fucking dorks. You guys are the biggest fucking dorks on earth, you know? And I guarantee you, they've never seen anything like this. But they just couldn't even, you know, and it's amazing how you can like the same kind of things or interests, like, you know, like you were talking about Jeff Porcaro. I'm sure they love Jeff Porcaro too, you know, but, and you can be from so two different places. Like, I only really like Jeff Porcaro, like the stuff he's done with Tommy Bolin, you know. I mean, Jeff Porcaro's played on so much studio shit that, you know, you wouldn't even know. I wouldn't know, like, you know, half of the stuff. But I know, you know, the stuff he did with Tommy Bolin was outstanding. Here, I'll show it to you. I wonder if I could put the light on this phone or it'll fuck it up. Let me see. I don't know if you'll be able to see it with this. Oh no, it's gotta go the other way. What am I talking about? Can I turn it around? Should I turn it around? No, I can't. I'll do it like this. Okay, let me get a... I gotta get a light. I have one in the van. I'm pretty sure I have one in the van. Oh, yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yeah, I do. Because I was just... I just got home, and I have a, where is that one? Let me see. Okay. Okay, where is that thing? I just had it. It's over here. Let me get this. Hang on, you guys. I think it's over here. Oh, here it is. Okay, I got it. Okay, are you guys there? Okay. Are you there? Yeah. Here, check it out. You see it? If I could get this thing to go into the landscape mode, I can't, it won't do it. I don't know why it won't do it. I'm holding it in landscape mode. How do I turn this into the landscape mode? I don't understand why it won't do it. Anyways, here, let me see. Do you... what I could really use right now is this thing going into the landscape mode. Can you see it? You can't see it real well. I gotta get this thing in landscape mode. How do I do that? Do I have to turn this off and put it back on? It says use the overheating protection setting. Okay, where is it? Oh, okay. How do I turn this to landscape mode? Do you know? It's gonna show you a button on the screen. I know, but it's not doing it. Oh, okay, let's try it. What is that? Oh, no, that's bullshit. It's filters or something. Off. Okay. This thing has to go into landscape mode. Okay, it says, use live indicator, focus on the camera. Camera key, front facing, save video, use live. What's this? No, that's just... Oh, okay. Well, at least this is... Now I can do it, sort of, and see... Okay, you see it now? See it? You see the pedals? But you see the snare? That's the snare. And the snare is a 10 inch. And there, here's the toms. Boom, boom, just two. Those two don't go down. They're just, I just have them attached onto the side. You see? And there's the other pedal, the other bass drum. There's the bass drum. And here's a bass drum and the hi-hat. And they all connect to the thing. I can close this up in one shot. Like, see the hi-hat slides in? See it slides in? And then the pedals, you put them, you turn them up and they fit on the flat on the side of the wood. And then you can just put it in the back of a car. And all that stuff I just take off, you know, the cymbals. And you'll see, here I'll show you it from the front. I gotta get out of this fucking thing. Oh, I should bring that in, huh? I'll come out here later. Here. Now this is it from the front. Here. You see? You see the beaters? See how the beaters come around the corner? And there's the hi-hat. And then here's the other beater. And it goes around the corner. You see there's the sprocket. And then it goes around. This is there. It hits those. Huh. The whole thing is like this. That's the whole drum kit. Yeah, it's cool, you know. It's like one of my friends was working on it in Sweden when we were touring, and I was helping him, and you know, it's really his thing, not mine, but you know, I gave him a lot of ideas, but he would have done it without me anyways, but he's very smart. But you see, like I told him, like, about the chute, like, you see the inside, that is it isolates the snare drum so that you see, you could see the little tom-toms, see the tom-toms, and there's the other tom, but the snare has that wooden box that goes all the way to the bottom so that the snare is isolated. Now see on the bottom, if you can see underneath, I'll show you. You see, right? You see under the bottom, that's the bottom snare head. See? And here, let me get this out of the way. You see, that's the bottom snare head under it. And it's bigger, like, since I don't have anything I have to put on the bottom, I run a 12-inch snare with the 10-inch on the top, 12-inch on the bottom. But of course it doesn't sound as good as like a drum set, but it sounds better than a cajon. You know? And it's a gimmick. It's like it looks like a washing machine or something. So people, you know, they come by and they look, and then maybe they throw a dollar, you know, or something. So it's an oddity, you know. It's an oddity, and I need all the gimmicks I can get, because I'm not like Jeff Picaro. I wish I was, you know. But yeah, so I need some gimmicks. But, yeah, it's a chain drive pedal, you know, they're both chain drive pedals. See, it has the sprocket on it, you see, and the other one. And even the hi-hat is a chain. But it's just, you know, it's a fun thing, man. It's just, it's a fun kit. Let me close it. I just got to close my van. Okay, so now you see what I'm saying. That, see, I don't know who said that, but they said it sounded like a, you know, tin can, and it, but it does, and I know, you know, like, what I was thinking was, oh, it's all right, you know, no problem. You know, like, if I could, like, I was thinking, like, if I could trigger my Rollins with that kit, I'd get both of the best of both worlds. I would get the oddity, it looking odd, and I'd get the great sound, you know? So I'm working on that, but, you know, it's like I'm trying to figure out how to do this streaming stuff, and all of it at one time is kind of like a lot for an old guy like me, you know? So, what's a PPL? I don't know what that is. Oh, yeah, right. Yeah, I see you. They meant the chain strap. Right, okay. On the bottom head of the snare. Right. That's right. Yeah, you know, it's a really great kit, man, just for sitting down and having fun. But it's like playing on a desktop, you know what I mean? It really is. It's like, I don't get the, you know, the rebound and stuff you feel off like a kit with like maybe like old Ludwig Octoplus toms and stuff, you know, that's really fun, or a sonar kit or something, you know. But it's not supposed to be that, you know. It's just like, you know, when Ludwig was making those cocktail kits, whatever they called them, I forget, those cocktail sets, and they were kind of cool, but they were kind of weird too. That looked like a conga, and there was like a pedal that would hit the bottom of it. Okay, I got you. But oh yeah, okay, people, yeah, all right, yeah, I will. I'll tell them what they are looking at. Sure, I didn't know if people were seeing it or not, you know, because the way I have the camera set, I haven't really done the things I should do for streaming, because I'm waiting to do this thing that I'm doing for somebody with music, and I'm going to make a decent amount for it. So I wanted to take that money and get some good stuff, like a good monitor, so that I can talk to people when I'm doing it, playing, and you know, like just have it much more in a controlled situation, so that I could not have to worry. Like tonight, things were breaking down, and I was getting pissed, you know. But yeah, you know, like even the speakers, I bought this JBL from this guy, and it was an active subwoofer, and let's just say it is not acting, it's non-active, but even using it passive, it's great. But I'm going to get it together so that the whole thing, because I would like to do like a little stream thing, you know, for people that, you know, for drummers and people that want to know about stuff, and just, you know, just for hanging out and stuff. Not like so much, like, I mean, Max's is like, you know, it's like a soap opera or something, you know? I mean, I really don't know how he can do that, because it would make me crazy, you know? I don't know, you know, just, he doesn't seem to care when people say things, and, you know, I mean, I'm not mean or something, like I would say something mean, but, you know, it does bother me if somebody is unhappy with me or something, or something, you know. I don't know, you know, I mean, maybe I don't know him well enough, maybe it does bother him, but I couldn't do that, you know, all that crazy stuff, and that he's got all these people on there, this Andy Dick guy, who, that guy's a crazy guy, and I know about him, I've seen him, but, you know, I want to get it down where it's more like, you know, like people that are really into music, and especially drumming, and you know, I always wanted to do like a vlog or a site like that, because drummers have just been screwed since the day one, and I don't think people know that enough. They really don't. They think I'm just saying that like I'm sour grapes or something, but That's not true. It's like drummers are always screwed. It's like they always tell them they're going to, they're going to cut them in on this and do this and that. And the drummers are always the ones that are like putting up the posters and, you know, the cheerleader of it all, like Joey Kramer was from Aerosmith. And he, you know, the story on him, he used to write the name Aerosmith on his notebook and before there was even a band. And people used to ask him what that was. And he'd say, oh, that's my band that I'm going to have. And this is even before they put the band together. And Joey Kramer, they just fired him. I mean, you know, it's like I told Max, and Max kind of laughs at it, but, you know, I'm pretty serious about it, that, like, when a drummer and a couple of guys go into a room and they don't have a song, and 2 hours, 4 hours later, they come out and have a song, it's like, all of a sudden, you act like the drummer wasn't there. Like they just split it down with the guys that made the melody. Okay, they're the ones that get the credit. I mean, I think that's a bunch of bullshit, because not only is the drummer there, but I hate to tell people, but the drummers usually are the ones that are the most involved in arranging, you know, because of the dynamics, you know, like when it goes back to a verse and it drops down, and the drummer, you know, does a, like a, you know, like a hi-hat crush to, like, signify it's dropping. He's usually one that suggests where to put them and things like that. And unless a guy when I say melody maker, I mean singer, guitar player, unless they hand a drummer a complete piece of work and it says where to play what, he's writing it too. And it's a shame, because so many drummers get screwed out of things, you know? And, you know, I mean, I just don't think there's a really good drum site where you just kick it around and, you know, it's candid too, like we're talking about, you know, drugs and things, which is fine, you know? I mean, as long as you're not perpetuating stuff. You're talking about, like, basically, like harm reduction, you know, I don't think there's a site like that, because all the drum sites I ever go to, there are always guys that are like, you know, they're either teaching or they're gushing over some other drummers or something. And I haven't really seen a site where, you know, it's the drummers just coming in and kicking it around, talking. And, about everything and anything. It doesn't even have to be about drums. But, you know, like my cousin, he's a guitar player. And I said, yeah, it would be great, you know, and have some people on there like that. It's like Dave Grohl, you know. He was a drummer, and then he goes and starts that band, the Foo Fighters. And he had that Taylor Hawkins drumming. And, I knew Taylor Hawkins. I met him. I wasn't really good friends with him, but I met him. And I knew Dave Grohl was a real anti-drug, you know? And I was thinking, I wonder how that works. And then somebody told me, well, you know, everyone in this band doesn't do drugs. And I was like, that's not true. And then you've seen what happened, you know? And I just wonder how he processed that, you know, that his buddy was... you know, his buddy was not being totally straight with him, you know. That's why I say all the time, I go, you know, I don't have any reason to lie. If somebody asks me, you know, when's the last time I used, I'd be glad to tell you. I could care less. Like I said, I'm not doing those things for recreation. It's like right now I'm sitting down on a couch because I have a very hard time standing for a while. That's really odd that, you know, the one thing that I was left in life with was being able to play my drums, although that is subjective. Some people would probably say differently, but I mean, at least I can sit down and play to my ability and have fun. But I can't stand in a line. I can't. I mean, my back, it was so messed up from a couple bad motorcycle accidents that, you know, so bad enough that, you know, I'm known as the scrunchback. But, you know, like I say, I want to have fun with a site, like, you know, real fun and real drumming and talk and stuff. And, you know, Max can do his thing. He likes it. You know, he's got to been doing it for a while, and there's all these people and characters and things, and that's all cool. I couldn't personally do that because, I mean, I've seen some of the people, and like this, that girl, she was over there. And you have to realize, I'm older, and when I see something like that, you know, it's like I have two sisters, and then I find out that this little girl has an alcohol problem, and I just don't think there's anything humorous about it. I think it's really sad, and, you know, I don't know, a lot of people... I'm sure there's people that would say I'm a male chauvinist or like a misogynist or something because I don't worry about guys that have drug problems that much and stuff. And that's probably true, maybe because I have two sisters. But, man, I mean, there's a lot of messed up people that come on there. And that little girl, forget her name, he says she's not that little. She's like 30 years old or something, but it doesn't matter. To me, that's little, that's young. 30-year-old boy is young to me. I'm old. And I just think that, you know, it's such a terrible... It's just really hard for people these days, and it's hard for young people. I mean, look at all the shit that's going on, you know? And, it's hard, man. I feel bad for young people because, man, I'm telling you, you know, the generations before them, not just mine, but the generations before them certainly didn't leave them with a lot of promise, man. You know, they left them with a lot of mess to clean up. Yeah, Goo, that's her name, Goo. Yeah, I feel bad for her, you know, because I can tell that, you know, she kind of likes Captain or something, and I don't know, in a way, and if it's a romantic like, but even if she just, I know she just at least likes him like a friend, and he kind of just, you know, thinks or says like, well, she's got a problem, you know, and like basically she has a problem, and that's her problem, and I'm like, yes, I understand that, man. I'm like, but for me, it's hard to be around people like that without wanting to try to help them or ask them, like, would you like help? You know, I would never be pushing on somebody or anything, but it's hard for me to know something is, like, amiss like that and that it could end up very bad when if somebody would just show some interest in their well-being. And I mean really, really... just that. I don't mean some guy like guys are, you know, some, like, you know what I mean, trying to mac on some kid that's like dysfunctional. That's just irreprehensible, and it's terrible for somebody to do that, you know. So that's why I was saying to Max, do you think you could help that girl? I mean, why don't you try to direction her into the right way somehow? You know, yeah, I mean, it's terrible that, I mean, you know, a kid doesn't, I mean, that is basically barely a kid. First of all, it's a girl. Second of all, you know, she could have the advantage, taken advantage of very easily. And second of all, being the 28 or so, that's still a kid. And I'm just saying, to have those kind of problems or to drink, it means something didn't go right in your life. Something probably pretty monumentally bad. And, you know, I mean, in my life, the bad things that went bad, I could pretty much say I did myself. You know, I caused it. So I take full responsibility. But you don't know where people come from. You know, you don't know what's happened or their life, and especially on the internet. And, but you can see definitely some damage And, you know, I just said, you know, I told him, I said, just at least if you're not going to direction somebody into maybe a place where they might be able to better themselves, at least don't contribute to the negativity and the downside, you know? And I don't think that Max would. I think he's an all right guy. But I'm just, the point I'm making is there's a lot of people there that gravitate towards that, that seem to be a little bit out there, you know? But, yeah, I know that it's not just drinking. I can obviously tell, you know, obviously that there's some definitely some loose ends there, you know, that need to be addressed. And, you know, I don't know that the environment of this RV thing is conducive for, you know, repairing. And then again, the bottom line is it could be just, it's none of my business, really. But just like I say, as an older person, you kind of feel that it is your business, that you need to say to some people, hey, you know, give this person some breathing room, man, you know, or something, you know. I don't know, man. I just, you know, my kid says, because he knows and he's heard about the way I grew up and the way I was and jail and drugs and stuff. And he says, Dad, are you just trying to be good because you're getting older and you want to get into heaven? And I said to him, I go, and? And? Better late than never, man. You know? I just wish that I was, you know, I told my sister I wish that I could have a do-over. And she said, why? So you could bet on the right horse? And I was like, no, not at all. The reason I wish I could have a do-over is so that I could treat people a lot differently in life. I never treated anybody really bad or poorly, but I could have been a lot more attentive, to at the least, you know? You know, and I think that, you know, it's like when you get older, I wish you could see this. You probably can see it if I get into the light. This cat has just jumped on my back. You stay out there. Don't try to jump off on anything now. Could you see him? Wait. This cat has just jumped on my back. Come here, boo. No, don't jump on the counter. You stay on there now. Can you see him? Can you see him if I hold the phone up? You see him? All right, go on the counter, you nut. Anyways, anytime, you know, I'm going to try to go on every day, or at least, you know, every day for a couple hours, around at least like from 4 o'clock up. And, you know, if you come on, let me know you're there, and, you know, we'll talk about some drum stuff and shit, you know? Because I have to, I got to go to bed. I think it's late already. Is it? What time is it? Oh, yeah, it's 2 in the morning. But so I'm going to sign off. But thank you for coming on and having interest. And it's very nice to have some friends, you know, on there. I don't have a lot of friends. And it's nice. But anytime, yeah, come on and remind me who it is. Oh, no, I already see. I know. We'll talk, you know. Where are you out of? What city? Are you out of L.A.? I don't know what that is. A midget. We'll submit it. Okay. Okay. Take care. Okay.